Welcome, everyone. We're hoping that those out in the atrium find their way inside the auditorium at this time so we can get ourselves started.
We can't figure it out.
We are so excited to see so many people coming out tonight. And we truly hope that tonight goes well. I'm not going to say go as planned because it's already changing plans as we constantly move through this evening. So tonight, on behalf of the Pioneer Valley Library Collaborative, our community partners, Voices for Climate, and the Westfield State University of Geography, Planning, and Sustainability, we welcome each and every one of you. We fully anticipate a great evening filled with questions and answers, and we want to always remind you, go to your public library. There is always more information to be found there. I am Lise Letellier. I am the current library director for the Granville Public Library and a founding member of the Pioneer Valley Library Collaborative. I want to take a moment to thank all of our sponsors and partners who you have been enjoying for the past 45 minutes, who are really responsible for supporting the environment in so many various ways, and who getting to share some of that with you in the atrium. We hope you had a chance to visit their tables prior to coming into the hall, and many of them will still be here for a short time after the forum, so you can visit them again or if you missed one of them. Before we begin our official program, I just want to mention there's at least one dignitary here tonight or representing a dignitary, and I believe that is Mark Messier, who is the, where is he, Mark? There you are. So Mark is the district director for Senator John Velas, who could not attend tonight due to prior commitments. And I just want to thank Mark, because I remember working with him with the Afghan families. So thank you, Mark, for being here. You're always a big help. And as of right now, I don't think there is anyone else, but there is a possibility somebody will be coming in, and if they come in, we will be interrupting our program to introduce that person. So I'd like to ask the audience at this moment in time, how many of you are here as a homeowner? Can you just raise your hand? Okay, awesome, a lot of homeowners. How about anybody who owns a business? Is there anyone here who owns a business? All right, next marketing thing we have to do is to the business people. how about renting an apartment or a house? Any of you rent? Okay, terrific. Thank you for coming tonight. How about representing a municipality? Okay, terrific. There's a couple of you here. That's good. How about farmers, our most special people? Any farmers here tonight? Okay. They're hard workers, and right now it's harvest time. I know at least in Granville, it's really close to harvest time. How about working for a nonprofit organization? Okay, all right. These are all really important. And why is it important for me to ask this? It's because I wanted our panelists to have some sense of who's in the audience tonight and what it is that they might be able to target as we do this. So before I begin tonight's, I had to keep changing my notes. So the first piece of definite unfortunate news regarding tonight our panelists is Senator Paul Mark. Senator Paul is the senator for 57 cities and towns of the Berkshire, Hamden, Franklin, and Hampshire district, the largest legislative district in the history of Massachusetts. And he currently is stuck in Boston doing his job. They're in caucus in regards to some tax breaks, and that's where he had to stay. So we apologize for the fact that he is not here tonight, but we know that we still have lots and lots of information to be able to share without him here. To get things started tonight, though, before we get into our panelists, we're going to have a little welcome. And this welcome is with Hamden District Attorney Anthony Golini. He was sworn into office in January of 2015 and is currently serving his second four-year term. He is a lifelong Springfield resident who attended local schools, including Western New England University. Anthony's earlier career included the Salvation Army, the City of Springfield, and as assistant district attorney. As district attorney, he has promoted his vision of a safer community by innovation and significant investment in community building, outreach, crime prevention, and education. His office has engaged with many community-based organizations, including the Healing Racism Institute of Pioneer Valley and the YMCA, and others, including us, to provide equitable services to all communities in need. Tonight, he's going to start us off with a little welcome. However, he's on his honeymoon. He got married last Saturday. So I got him to pre-record his message for us tonight. So please welcome D.A. Anthony Galluni.
Good evening, everyone. I am honored to be here today and to welcome you to the Clean Energy Incentives for All Forum. I am Hamden District Attorney Anthony Galluni, and it is a privilege to address so many passionate individuals, businesses, and nonprofits united by a common goal to usher in a greener, low-carbon environment for our community. Today, we come together during a time of historic investment that will aid in the transformation to a greener environment and economy. With historic investments by both the federal government and the state of Massachusetts, we are recognizing the urgency of addressing the climate crisis and the imperative of shifting away from fossil fuels and towards clean energy sources. Our mission is clear: to empower homeowners, businesses, and communities with the knowledge and resources to transition to a sustainable and greener future. Massachusetts has always been at the forefront of innovation, and it's only fitting that we lead the charge in this historic moment. Massachusetts is renowned for its rich history, but we are also pioneers in shaping a better tomorrow. The progress we seek will benefit all of us, as well as future generations, and that is precisely what this forum is about: how to do our part by accessing clean energy incentives and to leave our environment better off than the way in which we found it. This forum will explore the available state and federal incentives designed to make clean energy adoption a reality. It will explore the many ways in which individuals and organizations can benefit from these incentives, whether it's reducing energy costs, enhancing energy efficiency, or minimizing our carbon footprint. Together, we will discover the tools that will drive us towards a more sustainable future, both economically and environmentally. In my role as district attorney, I am often faced with very difficult decisions that affect people's lives and freedoms when our community's public safety is endangered. As prosecutors, we also realize we cannot arrest our way out of the challenges that we face. That is why my office has invested heavily in education, prevention, and rehabilitation. Our guiding compass is to do what is right and what is just. That's why I am grateful for all of you here today. Just like in criminal justice, we all have a part to play in fighting for climate justice. This is not about numbers and policies, it's about people. It is about all of us doing our part in ensuring everyone can play a role in this transformation. It's about supporting our communities, ensuring that the benefits of clean energy reach every corner of our state, especially our own. As we collectively begin this journey, let us be moved by the spirit of unity and shared purpose. The road ahead may be challenging, but together we will prevail. I want to thank every one of you for being here, for your dedication to a greener future, and for your commitment to our community. Your presence is a testament to the power of collective action and the belief that with determination and cooperation, we can make a difference. Thank you.
I hope he's having fun on his honeymoon. Next, a change in plans. As you notice, I had to skip through a couple of slides. I would like to introduce to you a person that's kept me at this moment very calm. I think her words were something like, with flexibility and grace.
Grace and flexibility.
So that's what we're doing tonight. So I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Beth Spong. the CEO for Dean's Beans, and I hope that you enjoyed some of that coffee out there. After a lifetime of entrepreneurship, mission-driven consulting, and 15 years as a nonprofit leader, Beth joined Dean's Beans Organic Coffee Company of Orange, Massachusetts, where, as I quote, respect and caring for the environment is paramount. Beth initially acted as a consultant to Dean Saigon. Is that how to say it?
Saigon.
So he could transition himself into retirement and his 30-year coffee company into a worker-owned cooperative. Beth, as the chief executive officer for Dean's Beans, whose, I quote again, ethical business practices are rooted in respect for the earth, the farmer, and our co-workers and the consumer, will tell you more about the story of how this company was one of the first companies in Massachusetts to implement solar energy into their business practices and what it can all mean for you. Welcome, Beth.
Awesome. We're all set. Hi, I'm Beth Spong. So happy to be here. Thank you, Lise. And how many people drink coffee in here? What do you know? How about that? So 65% of Americans drink coffee every day. And here are a couple of facts about coffee. Coffee is one of the most pesticided crops on the planet, after cotton. And that's a lot of pesticide. And coffee is grown in the global south. And so that part of the world is experiencing the impact of climate change more intensely and has experienced it much sooner than North America. So this summer, I found myself with everything that was happening in this region, the flooding and so much else, I thought, well, climate change has finally come home to New England because we have been spared a lot of the challenges, a number of the challenges until now. So Dean's Beans was founded by Dean in 1993. He was an environmental and indigenous rights attorney before he started a coffee company. And he was looking for a way to have impact on farmers. Many coffee farmers around the world are indigenous peoples. And so he saw this company as a way to have social, economic, and environmental impact in the coffee lands. And he thought, well, you know, if it doesn't work, I'll just make it into a nonprofit. You know, if it's not a successful business, if it can't be profitable to prioritize the environment and the planet and humans, well, then we'll make it into a nonprofit and raise money and do it some other way. And here we are 30 years later. It turns out to be a profitable way of doing business. And we, from the very beginning, have prioritized the climate. So it starts for our company with the mission and commitment to social impact. Our mission is to use specialty coffee as a vehicle for positive change. That's why we exist. So what we say is our purpose is to create social, economic, and environmental justice, and we sell coffee in order to do that. And so that's like at the foundation of the work that we do. And we make decisions based on that mission on a day-to-day basis. And so how that shows up is we work in the world of coffee. It's a very specific slice of the business world. And we work in specialty coffee, so large commercial coffee, Folgers, you know, the big brands in the can in the supermarket. Those are commercial coffees, not organic. And we work in specialty coffee, and all the coffee that we sell is organic and is fair trade, and I'll tell you what that means. So specialty means that it basically tastes better than commercial coffee. And it passes, it gets cupped, and it gets determined that it is a higher quality, a better experience, better flavor. So that's the specialty piece. Organic means that we are helping to protect the environment from the degradation that happens when pesticides, heavy pesticides, are used in farming land. That degrades the soil, which accelerates the impact of climate change. And the fair trade piece is a designation that's been around for about 25, almost 30 years. That means it's a set of business practices and principles that are about improving better working conditions, gender equity, and helping to eliminate child labor around the world. So the coffee that we sell adheres to those principles. Always organic, always fair trade. And we pay more for the coffee because it is organic and because it's fair trade. And of all the coffee that is grown in the world, only 3% of that coffee is grown organically. And of all organic coffee, so, and 1% of the total coffee grown, 3% is organic, 1% is specialty coffee. So we're in a little tiny slice, a little niche of the coffee world. And so what we are committed to is not leaving any important piece of the pie out, right? Our product and our business practices have to benefit people, they have to benefit the planet, and they have to be profitable or we wouldn't be a successful business. And that's how we determine sustainability. Can all these things be true? And in 1987, the United Nations defined the term sustainability as meeting the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. Doesn't that sound like a great definition of a sustainability? I'm going to say that again. Meeting the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. So that is what we're committed to. And how that shows up, I'm going to talk about what we do on a day-to-day basis in order to be a sustainable company, and then what we also are engaged in the coffee lands with coffee producers. And so what that looks like is we are committed to having our packaging be as environmentally friendly and compostable as possible. So that's a rapidly evolving field. And so we try to stay right at the leading edge of having it be as compostable as possible. Because if you are, how many of you recycle? Okay, and so you know that's a little bit of a racket, right? like you can't recycle the black things, but you could recycle the clear lid, but it has to be these numbers, and who knows where it goes when you take it to the recycling center. And so a lot of us are committed to the environment, but it's hard to know sometimes what do we actually do? And so we moved away from trying to make recyclable packaging, because a lot of packaging is commercially recyclable. So if you take it to a very specific recycling center, they could recycle it, but the closest one is in Wisconsin or something like that. So so we go with compostable packaging. Our beanery, which is what we call the facilities up in Orange, Massachusetts, have been solar powered since 2016, and we have solar panels on the roofs of both our big warehouse and the beanery where we do production. And so that's a big piece, and Dean did use some sort of incentive at that time to make that happen. We also choose energy efficient roasters. In the domain of coffee roasters, the one that we use, which is called, the brand is Loring, they are very committed to the environment as well. So the way that we're able to recycle, when you roast coffee, there's a little like parchment that comes off it. So that's called chaff. We recycle and compost that and give it to farmers, and they use it in their fields. And the burlap bags that the coffee comes in, we give that to farmers and gardeners, and they use it in the environment. And our roasters remove, in the process of roasting, remove particulates from the smoke so that what comes out of the building is has less environmental impact. So we're busy reducing, reusing, and recycling, composting, upcycling, and recycling. And we, the goal was, you know, in the language around carbon neutral, net zero, carbon positive, can also be confusing. But the our goal is to be net zero, and we have been net zero carbon emissions for since 2018. And what that means is the environmental, thank you. The environmental measures that we take don't just offset the carbon emissions that we generate, it far exceeds any carbon emissions that our business creates. So carbon neutral is, okay, I fly in a plane, but I pay this much money to offset the carbon use, and that helps the environment. So I'm still creating carbon emissions, greenhouse gases and emissions, but I try to balance it out. Net zero means I'm doing so much for the environment that I have a net zero impact in terms of greenhouse gases and emissions. So that's where we land, and a lot of that has to do with solar power and the projects that the farmers in coffee producing countries ask us to do with them, and also the fact that we are committed to reforestation. Deforestation is a huge deal in the coffee producing countries. Big commercial farm palm oil basically and coffee companies clear the land, and they plant sort of plantation-style rows of crops that grow in the sun. And that has a very deleterious impact on the environment. And so we work with farmers in the 11 countries that we buy coffee from to reforest. And hundreds of thousands of coffee plants and hardwoods and local fruit trees. So to bring biodiversity back into the area, which is critical for ecosystem health. And so that's how we're engaged in that, and have a commitment to be continuing to be net zero. How many of you know what a B Corp is? B Corporation. So basically, B Corporation is a corporation that's committed to people, the planet, and profit, or to people and the planet before profit. And so we are certified B Corp and have been also for the last 5 or 6 years. And we already were doing those things, but we thought, you know, it's important for us to add our voice to the movement in the world of business to say, yes, we're putting a stake in the ground. We are committed to this also, and we want to be part of this movement. So we're a B Corp. And we also really work hard to have some fun while we're trying to save the planet. So if you go to Green River Festival or Garlic and Arts Festival or Start on the Street in Worcester or any number of musical festivals and community fairs around Western Mass, you might see a truck that looks like this. And that's the Dean's Beans coffee truck where we serve hot and iced coffee and organic fruit slushies. So don't panic, it's organic. I just wanted to tell you a little bit about how, as a business that was founded on the values of prioritizing people and the planet before profit, how on a day-to-day basis we're doing our best to live those values, and how in partnership with coffee farmers around the world, we help to meet their needs for clean water, for biodiversity, for other crops that can help feed their families and their communities and that they can also sell, and for reforestation. So many different ways we partner with coffee producers around the world. And so thank you, and I think that's it. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to let you get out of that, and then boom, you're all set. Boom. Bob's your uncle.
Oh, my gosh. Sometimes I just wish we could all just do what some can do, you know? But thank you. I appreciate it, and I appreciate it in a couple ways that you aren't going to be fully aware of. But we were delaying. She was supposed to be at the end. We put her at the beginning. But at this moment in time, I want to introduce somebody. And this person that I'm going to introduce to you, his name is Larry Cretion. And when we see Beth, what she has done in her company, Larry is here to try to do it for all of us. Larry Cretion is the executive director of the Green Energy Consumer Alliance, a 41-year-old nonprofit organization serving both Massachusetts and Rhode Island, whose organization's mission is to harness the power of consumers to accelerate the transition into a low-carbon economy. They do this through advocacy and offering solutions for consumers with renewable energy, energy efficiency, and electric vehicles. His home, office, phone, and car are all powered by wind. But previous to this, he directed programs to assist low-income people through energy efficiency and fuel assistance in Quincy, where he also previously served four two-year terms as city councilor. Larry is going to start our panelist discussion, and I know it seems like the panelists have decreased. Jonathan Schrag, who I will introduce when he arrives, should be here in about 8 minutes. I tell you, I'm laughing, flexibility with grace. That's the goal. So I'm going to start, Larry. He assured me, and I know for certain, that every one of the questions that we as a group put together tonight, hopefully to help you understand some things, he can answer. So we're going to start with this question. Why have you chosen to focus your work so wholeheartedly on decarbonizing our state economy and supporting fellow citizens to take advantage of these clean energy incentives? Why do you think these incentives are so important at this time, and why should we learn about them?
Hi, everybody. I want to say, first, I'm inspired, and I'm caffeinated, so watch out.
Nice.
Yeah.
Good combo.
Yep. To answer the question, one of my heroes is the young woman from Sweden, Greta Thunberg. He says that we have to treat the climate crisis like a crisis. And so every day I wake up and I work with great people at my organization, and we are trying to speed the transition to clean energy, to zero carbon.
Mic a little closer.
I will, I'm sorry.
Oh,
so
yeah, much better.
Every day we try to speed the transition to a zero carbon future. We're getting there, but we're not getting there fast enough. But the opportunities are right in front of us. All the fossil fuels that we've used by choice. We can blame the oil companies and the gas companies and the coal companies. I used to say that George Bush and Donald Trump could not stop us from buying solar panels and electric cars and things like that. And today, now we have the Inflation Reduction Act, which we're going to talk about. It doesn't mean a damn thing unless you, everyone in this room, starts looking at the incentives that come from the federal government and the state government and start making choices that will switch us off from fossil fuels to zero carbon energy devices. What that means is we need to have zero carbon electricity, whether it's offshore wind power, it could be solar panels like at Dean's on your house or what have you. And it means we have to electrify everything. Everything has to go to electricity, and that means electric cars, electric trucks, commuter rail, everything you can think of. An electric car is cool, an electric bus is cooler, an electric school bus is the coolest, and those are the choices we have to make as citizens, not just as consumers. And then we have to stop burning fossil fuels in the home. So that means heat pumps instead of heating oil and gas systems or propane. And we have to go to heat pump water heaters, induction stoves, and we have to go to electric dryers. All those choices. The good news is that there are incentives. The technologies are getting better. The bad news is we have to make a lot of decisions. Every one of us has to make all these series of decisions, right? So many different purchases. It's a lot harder than it used to be, right? You used to just move into a house, and it had a heating source, and you got your electricity from the government. But now we have to do things. But the Inflation Reduction Act is a game changer. It's the largest investment in the climate crisis that the world has ever seen. It's not all that we need, but it's a huge commitment of federal resources, and we need to take advantage of it. When they passed the Inflation Reduction Act in the summer of last year, they estimated, the feds estimated it was going to have an investment value of about $369 billion. But now, but because so much of the investment is in the form of tax credits, it's actually dependent upon how much businesses and individuals will go after these incentives. And now they think the investment will be triple that, which is good news. That's what we need. We need to accelerate the purchasing and investment decisions that people make. So it's working, and we just got to keep at it. And then the state of Massachusetts has a slew of incentives as well, have for a long time, keep adding to it. And it does get a little complicated trying to figure out how to match the incentives from the feds and the state. That's partially why I'm here tonight, is help maybe explain that. I got to put a plug in. I think that you all got a handout that with links to a Google Doc that has a digital resource library. And I checked it out, and go to it and click on it, and you will see a lot of good information about how to access the incentives at the federal and state level.
And actually, you know, so Larry, why don't you just, I am going to have you continue, because gee whiz.
I'm the only one here.
Nope, Bess is here too, so we were like, yay. Anyways, I wanted you to actually talk a little bit about those incentives. If you'd be willing to, you know, you can start either the federal, because Larry knows all of it. So whichever you would like to, you mentioned the Inflation Reduction Act and that there are incentives. So why don't you talk a little bit about those incentives? You can either start with Massachusetts or federal, whichever you'd like to do.
I'll start with federal and go to state. But we have had for many, many years, the federal government would have incentives for solar tax credits, for example. But they usually 2 or 3 years at a time, and then it would get close to the expiration date, and then we would all hope that they would extend it, and they were doing that. But one of the big moves of the Inflation Reduction Act is it extended the tax credits for not just for solar, but for heat pumps, air source heat pumps, ground source heat pumps, geothermal, and for many other energy efficient technologies. And said that the incentives would be available for at least 10 years. Basically, 30% tax credit for solar until 2032. And then for the next couple of years after that, it goes down to 26%. And that's very important. All these incentives for solar and energy efficiency are available to you for 10 years. So that here's the big takeaway. Is you got to make a plan, okay? This is not a sprint, okay? We have a climate crisis, but we don't all have to run out of here tonight and spend $50,000 to change our lives immediately. Within the next 10 years, try to get to net zero, and the incentives will be there for you. And so there's ways of planning this out in order to do that. So the incentives, the big incentives to talk about are, again, the solar tax credit. There's also a tax credit. We talked about electrifying heat pumps, heating, going from fossil fuels to heat pumps or to heat pump water heaters. You can get tax credits of up to $2,000 per year. That's what's important, is it's not a one-shot deal. If you were to do, so I'll use myself as an example. This year, my wife and I were going to install a heat pump water heater and get a $2,000 tax credit. Because we're coupling that with, we upgraded the amperage in our electrical service, we get an extra $600 to help pay for that. So that's our 2023 investment. But in 2024 or five or so, we'll go back and we will, eventually we'll do heat pumps for the entire house. The incentives for electric vehicles. Before the Inflation Reduction Act, there was a $7,500 tax credit that a lot of people took advantage of, but the government said that if a car maker produced 200,000 electric cars, then they wouldn't their cars would not be eligible for any further tax credit. And so Tesla and General Motors sold 200,000, then for a while they were not eligible for the tax credit because they were too successful. That's, people wanted their cars, but that was the federal policy at the time. Now that limit's not there anymore, and so now the car can be eligible for the next 10 years, and up to $7,500. There are limits to it based upon your income, which makes sense. In order to get the tax credit, your income cannot be above $300,000. If you have income over $300,000, you don't need a federal income tax to pay for the car. The car has to be under a certain purchase point, $80,000 for an SUV or a pickup truck, $55,000 for a sedan. If you can pay $81,000 for an SUV, you don't need the federal tax credit for the EV. And so now the message I'm going to say to you on that one is do not buy another gas-powered car ever again. Because if run your car, you know, when you're ready and you need to get another car, look hard because there are a large number of electric vehicles on the market, coming on the market every day. Another aspect of the Federal Inflation Reduction Act was they gave big tax credits for companies to build up manufacturing of solar panels and then build up heat pumps to build electric cars in the United States, assemble batteries in the United States, do the mining in the United States. And we have seen tens of billions of dollars being committed, and there are factories sprouting up all over the country, mainly in the red states, which is a little weird, a little ironic, but it's happening. And so now that more and more electric cars and heat pumps and solar panels will be coming from built in America, which is a great thing to do as well. So the key take home here is we get 10 years for the federal tax credits, and those can be combined with the state incentives. So Massachusetts has some great incentives. You can go, one program is called SMART for solar energy. Another one is called net metering. But those have been around for a while. They will be around because Massachusetts has made a commitment to being a leader in solar energy. Actually, I think we're number two in the country in amount of solar per square mile. And that's a big part of our climate plan is to have lots of offshore wind and lots of solar and other renewable resources. So if you think that your property is good for solar, the next few years are a great time to make that happen because you've got a good state incentive program that can be married with the federal tax credit. Again, the heating systems, most everyone here probably is with National Grid, Eversource, or Unitil. I know some of you might be with the Westfield Gas and Electric, I suppose, but if you're part of Unitil, National Grid, or Eversource, you've probably heard of the Mass Save program. Raise your hand if you have. That program's been around a long time. It's been very effective, one of the most effective in the country, where it's a great place to go to get a free energy assessment on your home or business, and then to get big rebates, incentives, and loans to get work done in your house. Whether first thing you should look at is insulation and air sealing, but there have been incentives over the years for upgrading your oil or gas heating system to something more efficient. Now we're pivoting because the science is now telling us that we have to electrify. So it's a big theme for tonight.
Just want to pull this a little closer too.
All right, no problem, sorry about that. So the big theme is electrification. So now Mass Save is encouraging us all to make our next purchase of heating equipment to be air source heat pumps or, if possible, geothermal ground source heat pumps. And you can get a rebate of up to $10,000 for the heat pumps. And that's if you're an oil or propane or gas customer. So the story here is this, is when you're ready, you can look to marry the Mass Save incentive with the federal tax credit. And you can do this over time. There are big, Mass Save is also offering generous incentives for heat pump water heaters as well. So the point is get a good energy assessment, figure out what you need, look at your own property, what's likely to go first. If you have, for example, central air conditioning, that's not going to last forever. You want to replace that central air conditioning with a heat pump that will provide you with high efficiency heat and cooling at some point. So we're trying to get people to plan ahead and to electrify within the next 10 years. And again, as I said, if you need a car, there's really, I would argue that it might be a bad move to buy a gasoline-powered car in the next couple of years, because you'll be paying more for gasoline than those of us who have electric cars know how much cheaper it is to run an electric car on electricity. The maintenance is almost zero. But at some point, the resale value of a gasoline-powered car will be lower, because we're going from landlines to cell phones is sort of the equivalent, a major change. And you know, just another thing that's not an incentive to a consumer, but Massachusetts has adopted a policy called the Advanced Clean Cars Rule. We couldn't do on our own, but we could piggyback onto California. Starting in 2026, 38% of the new cars sold in Massachusetts will have to be electric. And by 2035, 100% of the cars sold in Massachusetts will have to be electric. And so you're going to... Yeah. So what that means is the car companies, there's a few states that are doing this, California and New York and Rhode Island and Oregon, Washington, and a few others. They're going to start, the dealers are going to start having more electric cars on their lots, because the car company has to deal with this. So there probably will be an increasing number of cars, deals to get, plus we've got these incentives. So the message I'm trying to get at here is plan it out, and some of us may go with the heat pump first. Some of us might go with the electric car first. We don't all have to go in the same pattern.
And Larry, that's actually one of the questions that I wanted you to touch on for us. That it, you know, when we're here tonight, whether we're individuals or nonprofits or representing a municipality, you know, we want to be able to save money. At the same time, we want to reduce our carbon emissions. But if we could only choose one place to put our resources, where would you say is our best arena? Do we focus on our transportation, or do we focus on our buildings? Which would more likely have the most impact, recognizing that there are lots of personal factors that influence this decision? Basically, if you could say, here's the one thing I would choose and why would you choose it?
No, that's going to differ. For everybody's going to have a different answer. Honestly, that's the honest answer. It's going to depend upon your family situation and how much you drive, the condition of the car that you have, the condition of the heating system that you have, whether or not you can't do solar in some cases because you get trees or your whatever. We're all going to have a different pathway to net zero, and that's okay. I'll give you an example. Massachusetts has a climate plan where roughly we need to have 1 million homes putting heat pumps in by 2030. You know, that's almost a third of the homes in Massachusetts, and roughly 1 million electric cars by 2030. You know, those can be the same people or different people. It honestly doesn't matter. We just need to buy 2 million clean things by 2030, okay?
Thank you.
And so some of us might double up and give somebody else a couple more years to get with the program. That's okay. But so we encourage everyone to try to figure out what's right for them. And there are resources, organizations like mine will help you figure out what's right for you and so forth.
Okay. So let me ask you this then. What do you think is pretty much the best way for people to start, besides coming here tonight, to learn about the specific incentives that pertain to their particular situation or interest? What do you think is the best way for them, whether they're a homeowner, a business person, or a renter?
So if you go to the digital resource library that was, it's on the green piece of paper, I think, for your home, the best website I have seen or the best tool is rewiringamerica.org. And you go to that and you put in your zip code and your household income and whether you own or rent, and that will tell you what you're eligible for from the Federal Inflation Reduction Act. And it will produce a number. It'll list all the things that you're eligible for based upon your income, because some things are income determined. And it'll give you a total figure, like essentially your Uncle Sam bank account for clean energy, heat pumps and heat pump water heaters and things like that. And again, you've got 10 years. Look at that list and see and pick, start picking things off over time. You know, some people might want to, maybe their stove craps out. Good time to go get an induction stove that runs on electricity, and then you reduce something, you're eliminating a source of indoor air pollution. All these different things are in the Rewiring America tool. And then, you know, you can, our organization runs a lot of webinars. We did one, I think it was yesterday, on EV charging. Go to our website, greenenergyconsumers.org, go to our events page, and we always have webinars on where we explain what's going on with the Inflation Reduction Act, or we've got a great person named Loey Hayes who knows everything about the heat pump incentives, and she does Heat Pump 101. Hundreds of people sign up for her, each one of her webinars. So we keep doing them. No matter how many times we do them, people want to learn a little bit more about the heat pumps. Same thing on EVs. Anna Vanderspeck, who works for me, I think is the state's most knowledgeable person on EVs. She'll be speaking at the Garlic Festival in a few days.
In Orange, Massachusetts.
Yeah, and she likes coffee, I'll tell her. There are ways. Solar it's a mature industry now in Massachusetts. Go to our website. We have a way where we work with a company called Energy Sage. You can get 7 competing bids for your roof. You put your name into our form, and you'll get 7 bids from local installers. And they won't contact you until you ask to be contacted. And then when you have questions, you can reach out to Energy Sage, and they'll guide you through so that you can make sense of the competing bids. We do the same thing with heat pumps. Loey explains heat pumps to you, but then we have a way of allowing you to get bids from heat pump installers. We work with a company called Abode Energy Management and also Energy Sage for that. Honestly, there's almost a gold rush on heat pumps, and the installers are pretty busy, and so no promises how long it might take to get an installer out to you. And it's going to be that way for a while, I think. Demand is kind of outstripping supply. You got to go to the MassSave website, look at it quite a bit for the basics of energy efficiency and for the incentives for heat pumps. But just can't and don't overlook MassSave. It's been around a long time, but it's the place you really should start with.
And that's one of the last questions I want to ask you before we put it out to their questions. And I know that tonight we have Westfield Gas and Electric for those people who are here. We have in Westfield, we also have CET, and we have Homeworks. These are all three people that are connected to or through MassSave or not, but how to kind of start. But really, I maybe it's because my husband's a builder and I kind of think about this sort of thing. It's like, so if I want to have a solar put in, I'm going to think about wanting to contract. Who's going to do it? Is that really the best place for people to start, is finding a contractor, or should you be starting with these MassSave, CETs, Westfield Gas and Electric first? Do you think is the best way for people to start their research or start the process if they want to do it?
I would always start with the MassSaves and the CETs and the Westfields. And, you know, unless it was my brother as the contractor or something like that, I would want to know exactly what I need to buy, and I would make them compete. There's a lot of good installers in Massachusetts, but no matter, you know, how much you might love them, almost anything that costs more than a few bucks, get 3 bids anyway. But it's possible, especially with heat pumps and solar, it costs a lot of money. And it's not always just trying to get don't always pick the lowest bid. Get a good bid where they can explain everything. The installer needs to be able to give you a product that is eligible for the federal tax credits and the Mass Save rebates. We hear occasionally where a consumer gets a visit from a contractor and says, well, is this going to be eligible for this tax credit or this incentive? And the installer says, I don't know. That's, you know, that's just not the kind of installer you want to hire. They should all be getting with the program. And so that's key. So you need someone who's technically qualified with good references and make them compete.
All right. We're going to get you to answer a few more questions, no longer the ones that our core committee has put together. It's now time for us to open it up to you folks. There are two microphones. There is one down here, one down there. So if you could stand on, perhaps on the stairs, so that way we can, there'll be a monitor, somebody there from our team. And that way we can take one at a time. And I'm going to start on John's side over here. And then I will go to Colleen's side over here. So please use both of these so that we can move through our question and answers. And we are still waiting for Jonathan Schrag to get here. So, all right. Cher, your person.
When you need a new roof and you have the solar panels on top, how expensive is it to have them removed?
Honestly, I don't know the exact figure. It shouldn't be a breaker on your budget. You probably had the solar panels installed many years ago.
I don't have them now, but I'm just wondering if I get the solar panels and say then years down the road I need to replace my roof, I'm going to have all the solar panels removed and then put back up.
Well, so if your roof needs to be replaced soon.
No.
I'm
just saying years down the road.
All right. So if the roof's in good shape, then go ahead and install the solar panels. It won't be much of a cost in the future to have the roof replaced, have the contractor come out. And you've already bought the panels. You've already bought the inverters to take them down and put them back up. It should work out just fine. It's a minor additional cost to the roof, but it shouldn't stop you. You're going to get Massachusetts incentives plus the solar tax credits make solar a winner. If you have a good roof that's south-facing or southwest-facing, and no trees over the roof or anything like that, you should do the solar. That's the bottom line.
How will the utilities be out during that time?
Will the utilities
while the panels are off the roof, would the utilities be down?
No.
No, because you'd have your battery.
Not just 99% of the solar installations in Massachusetts are what we call interconnected with the utility. So you're not going off the grid. You're going to be using the solar power as much as you can. And when it's the sun's not shining, you'll be using electricity from the grid. So if you took the solar panels down, you'd just be using the electricity from the grid.
Okay, thank you.
All right, and before we get any further, though, I know driving from Boston can be very unpredictable, and highway traffic can be stopped. And so I would like to take a moment to introduce a very important person. And though he didn't necessarily get a chance to do some of the questions, I know he can answer some questions. And we might put a couple out to him. So I'd like to introduce who just arrived, Jonathan Schrag. He is the Deputy Climate Chief and the Director of Investment for Decarbonization and Reliance in the Office of Climate, Innovation, and Reliance for the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Jonathan specializes in regulatory strategies and innovation for energy transition. Some of his previous projects have included helping Rhode Island develop competitive projects for the bipartisan infrastructure law. He co-authored recommendations for the new regulatory framework to encourage the transition of gas utilities in Massachusetts for the Office of the Attorney General. And he also consulted for the Public Service Commission of Louisiana to evaluate the advanced meter and grid modernization petition of Southwest Electric Power Company. This is only a sample of the depth of his knowledge into our topic tonight. So we are going to give him a chance first to welcome, and if there's something that you would like to say before we go to our next question, Jonathan, please take a couple moments to do that.
Hi, Nate. Welcome. That's very kind of you all. Thank you, and thank you all for coming out tonight. It's really, there's a lot you could be doing, and it's exciting to see so many people here, some familiar faces, a lot of not familiar faces. I'm Jonathan. I work in Boston. I live in Boston 5 days of the week. There is 5 acres of ash trees that are mostly dead that I try to manage with a little cabin on the border of Mount Washington and Sheffield and Salisbury, Connecticut. So I get out that way as often as I can. I could not say that I was lost getting out here or that it was unpredictable, but there was a tractor trailer that turned over. And so it hung me up a little bit. So I apologize. We are a newly created office in January with the governor. Her first day of office, she created the Office of Climate. And the idea was to have a small entity within the governor's office that is operating across all 12 secretariats of government to help think about climate. And you would be surprised. You talk to veteran services, you talk with public safety, and you say, what do those have to do with climate? And you get talking to them and you understand that they're actually training returning veterans for jobs to put windows in. Or they are thinking about how they can use a ground source heat pump to rehabilitate an old and aging prison. Or they're training their prisoners behind the walls for what they're gonna do when they get out from in front of those walls. And all of the climate workforce needs that the Commonwealth will have is, you know, that's a great opportunity. So we have DOT, which is moving stuff around and building highways. What will that look like? What will our turnpike exchanges look like, those rest areas when we are electrifying? Currently, there's not really a great electric option when you're driving on the turnpike. You've got all those gas pumps. How do we map out what that relatively small real estate looks like on the night before Thanksgiving when you've got everybody coming through trying to charge? We have our Energy and Environmental Affairs office that is really leading policy development on climate. We are acting to integrate all of those pieces, and we take a major focus on federal funding. I've got a colleague in the governor's office, Quentin Palfrey, who is thinking about big projects and who is managing the federal delegation. And on climate matters, we have an excellent partnership where we are working together to make sure that moms and pops and municipalities and businesses can figure out how to access the money that's needed, or that's available and that's needed. I'll say a couple of high-level points. Thing number one, in Massachusetts, as in the rest of the United States, we do not have the money that we need to decarbonize. We just don't. You know, if you read the analysis of fancy Wall Street firms, they will say that the Inflation Reduction Act and bipartisan infrastructure law may represent between 8% and 30% of the total investment that is needed. So that means that the rest of us are going to have to pay between 92% and 70% of what is needed. That sounds like an enormous amount, and it is an enormous amount. But then you've got to think that, like, gosh, in 7 years, you were probably going to buy a car again anyway. And in 20 years, you were going to have to do something to your heating system anyway. And in more years than that, that home is going to have to be retrofitted anyway. You're going to have to get into the walls and think about insulation and windows. So it becomes a question of coordination. How do we time this in a way that at the moment of turnover of that piece of fossil-based infrastructure, we are matching the private investment that the business or the mom and pop would need to make with the publicly available incentive from the federal government and whatever state extra piece is needed so that we can persuade everyone to do that non-fossil incentive? And how can we do that for a long enough period of time that the manufacturers of the heat pumps and the electric vehicles actually squeeze all that excess out of their supply chains? They manufacture enough of it that it becomes cheaper over the long term. And you go to Home Depot and the air source heat pump is actually less expensive than the gas fossil. So that's the project we have in front of us. I think a lot about tax credits. It's complicated, we're not allowed to like give advice on taxes to businesses or to municipalities. But the vast majority of value in the IRA is in tax credits. In 10 years' time, the story will be written where those tax credits will be, were realized. Some government accounting office will do a report. And a lot of my job is to figure out with my colleagues how we can make Massachusetts suck up more of those tax credits than other locations. And so how do we use your dollars, federal grant dollars, state dollars, matching, all of that together to really leverage those tax credits and get projects done? That's the overview.
Thank you.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
I'm happy to stick around.
It's really important for us to recognize that in the state of Massachusetts, we have this position. That are doing this hard work way harder than I could ever possibly think about doing. So I thank you for that. I have one question that I held off on in our time that I am going to go, and then you're going to be next, okay? You know, I had asked, where should we begin with incentives? But we had another piece of that, and that was, you know, where should we start? How should we start to do it? But in addition to that beginning of how to get going, it's especially challenging for low and moderate income households to transition to these cleaner forms of energy. So we are asking, how are the Massachusetts and federal incentives designed to help support those households transition into cleaner energy? You know, I'm going to give an example of in our own lives. We have a home that we rent to an Afghan family. We want to bring in clean energy, but we don't want it to cost them any more money. So we're willing to make an investment, but what about those daily prices that they have? So I'm wondering if both of you, because I left it off for both of you, and Beth, if you are always welcome, just let me know you want to pop in. How would you answer that, or what are we doing for that?
So I hear two different questions there. The first is sort of what are we doing with the incentives? How are they structured to address what we call environmental justice populations? But then also that question about operating costs, particularly with respect to electrification. So if you were to go to a number of affordable housing developments and you were to offer people an air source heat pump, a number of them might say, I don't want that because it's going to drive my bills up. And that's sort of a, so first I think you got to own the problem. You have to recognize that MassSave, the major energy efficiency program, $1.3 billion a year of ratepayer money going, administered by a coalition led by the utilities, program administrators, has not done a great job of accessing environmental justice populations or making those incentives taken up by those populations. So I think you have to own the problem. Two, you've got to recognize that to redesign incentives, to design a just energy transition, you have to listen to communities. And so this administration's hired Maria Belen Power, who is from an organization called Green Roots. There's an environmental justice council with people appointed by the governor so that there can be voices where we're actually listening and having a little bit of accountability. These people are helping Larry keep us honest. And not that he needs much help. We are really doing what the federal government has asked us to do, which is to prioritize benefits for income-eligible environmental justice populations. We need to prove in every application that 40% at a minimum of the benefits are going to environmental justice populations. And there's all kinds of different definitions, and Massachusetts actually has a definition that is broader than the federal definition. We include language, which I think is super important, just being marginalized. But we need to prove that we're able that this program is designed to provide those benefits. So we've got two big things that are in the hopper. One is called Solar for All, which is, these are pieces of something called the Greenhouse Gas Reduction Fund, run by US EPA. The Greenhouse Gas Reduction Fund is a $7 billion competitive program. Massachusetts is going to apply. States are eligible to apply, are the only states in what they call tribes, which still gives me the heebie-jeebies when I hear that federal phrase. They are eligible to apply. And we will apply for a couple $100 million, which is the most we're eligible for. And that is designed to put solar panels on income-eligible housing. So that's going to be, and we're going to do that at scale. That's going to be publicly regulated affordable housing, so your municipal housing authorities. And it's going to be privately developed affordable housing. There is an income, a percentage income ceiling, and I don't have it off the top of my head what that is. But Mass Housing is a major partner in most affordable housing. The example you gave of privately owned, non-multifamily is a challenge that we recognize. So in our Solar for All proposal, we've carved out a single family bucket of money to go for those. Now I have to say, I suspect there will be some prioritization of single family homes that are owned by income eligible, but I'm actually gonna raise your example, I'm gonna raise with the team and make sure that we're still in the program design phase, that we are able to include those kinds. So that's one. The second is the National Clean Investment Fund. The state's not eligible to apply for that, but we are the deployment partner for that. There are four not-for-profits who are sort of consortia that are competing. That's a $14 billion competition. US EPA is gonna choose 2 to 3, so there's gonna be one loser. And the states are all kind of, so twice a week I'm on a phone call with 50 states, and we heard this from that person, and we heard this from that person, and everyone's sort of cutting deals and figuring out how their deployment programs match up with the plans of each of the bidders. And the position that Massachusetts is taking is we want to see ourselves in every application because we don't know who's going to win. But whoever wins, we want to make sure that we find avenues in Massachusetts for their programs to be successful. And we certainly have, there's some applicants we think match up better. Governor Healey created the Massachusetts Community Climate Bank with $50 million of state money. That's based at Mass Housing. It's very affordable housing focused. It's to do heat pumps, boiler replacement, building envelope, all of those kinds of measures. And we think that there are some of those applicants who could provide significant hundreds of millions of dollars of deal flow through Mass Housing. So those are some of the big ways, okay, both in terms of participation and big programs.
Thank you. And I know that we
I
have just,
much,
you know,
I'm
we
sorry.
Have a little, no, that's okay. No, it's so important and it's so valuable and I really wanted
I'll
the opportunity.
I'll stick around
to
for questions for people because I was
definitely.
Late. I know you all may have places to go.
And I want to make sure
around.
That we, and so the next piece of this as our questions, they've all read it. You guys haven't all heard it. You folks haven't heard it. Is that succinct questions, succinct answers. We'll try
sorry.
To get through as many as we can. How's that? Okay, you are next.
Hi. Sounds like I'm on the right track. I started off at my municipal electric company. They pointed me to CET. CET, I had a consult with them, went next zero. They mentioned, to keep it succinct, they mentioned along the way something called the High Efficiency Electric Home Rebate Act. Another bucket of money out there. You folks haven't spoke to that. You spoke to the IRA, which is tax credits. So that's another bucket of money we'd like to hear about.
Yeah.
You mentioned along the way there's a bucket of money of state money. What are the specifics around that.
So Homes HERA is energy, it's two different programs, both energy rebates. The program has been announced. The program has been announced, but the money has not flowed yet. The state, all states need to provide a plan for how they're going to provide those rebates, and that is due in January of 2024. It's formula funding. I believe the total, I think it's $72 million each. So those programs exist on paper, but the money has not yet been deployed by USDOE. The state money that I refer to is really the bulk of the state money comes through Mass Save, which is energy efficiency. And if you're in a municipal light district, it's tough because you don't pay in. You have a local plan, if you're lucky to have one. The $1.3 billion is really National Grid and Eversource and Unitil.
Okay.
Rate payer paid, yeah.
All right.
So that's a special challenge that, you know, we need to figure out.
And I, with that said, before I go to the next question, I want to remind people, it's really important. Westfield Gas and Electric is out here. CET is out here. Homeworks is out here. I know when we went through Mass Save, it kind of directed us out. When we went to another direction, it directed us. So please remember that they are out here willing to take your questions and how to contact. Okay, you are next over here, Cher.
I think Larry's also eager.
Oh, I'm sorry. Larry, did you want to speak to that?
Just a quick thing.
Okay. Sorry.
You pay a lot less for electricity in Westfield than I do in Quincy, where I have National Grid as the utility. And so if a heat pump is in your future, it's going to cost you less to run the heat pump. So keep that in mind as you think about things over time and watch for the programs that Jonathan said will be rolling out in January, which are income qualified are those programs. So I don't know if you'd be eligible or not.
Thank you. Please remind me if I miss you. Back over here now.
I understand that cities have direct access to federal funds, but I don't understand how they can access federal funds. Can you explain that?
Yeah, previously, there's a few different kinds of funds. There's a lot of grant programs coming out of the Federal Inflation Reduction Act and the bipartisan infrastructure law that was passed before that. And those grants are coming through U.S. Department of Energy or U.S. EPA. And the message I've been saying is every city or town hall ought to be looking at those programs and assigning someone the time it takes to look for the grants and apply for them. They're available. There will also be more loans coming out, the Green Bank, the federal level, the state level. But in particular, a big change that we love is that most of clean energy until the Inflation Reduction Act was based upon a tax credit, and you had to have what's called a tax appetite. You had to be a taxpayer, either a wealthy individual or a company that had a big tax liability, and then you could take the tax credit off on your taxes. But what they did with the Inflation Reduction Act is they said tax-exempt entities, it could be a public agency, it could be city or town hall, it could be a housing authority, it could be my organization as a nonprofit or a church. If you're tax-exempt, it's called direct payment. It's like a tax credit. They'll actually send you a check for the equivalent amount. So if it could be 30% for the solar panels or something like that, and you just might have to wait a year for the check, so you got to plan that with your cash flow, but that would be available. And it opens up opportunities, I guess, to try to keep the dollars local. Previously, Wall Street was funding a lot of clean energy projects, and there's still an option for somebody to use, but now it could be more nonprofit or publicly owned.
Jonathan, do you need it to add anything?
We're still processing the guidance from the IRS, and like, it's not easy. it's confusing, and asking small municipalities to read that guidance and take a risk when they're building a school, you know, a $3 million bet that they're going to get a check in 3 years, is a big risk. So figuring out how we can make it easy, how can we price in the tax credit? I mean, ideally, it's like a coupon, right? Like you It's easier when you go to Home Depot and the coupon is just priced into the price. When you have it and you have to then like mail the receipt in and then someone sends you a check 60 days later, for the IRS, you need to demonstrate that the measure is in operation. So if you're building in a ground source heat pump for a school, it can take 3 years to build a school. So how do we create some kind of bridge loan or some easy process, some 1, 2, 3, follow these steps? We're in direct conversation with the Department of Treasury, trying to get them to do like a plain English guide, which they think they've done, with the greatest of respect.
Yeah. And I want to take it down to one step. I'm from Granville. Yeah. I live in Tolland.
Yep.
You have a place in Sheffield.
Yep.
We're not building schools, but we do need to have ways. So get it even smaller.
Yeah.
Keep that in mind. Right over here.
Hi, the first question is for my son. He lives up country a little bit. He needs a heat system. I told him about the program. He's interested, but he said he may, if he moved back to the area and he'd be in a different home, would he be eligible twice? Could he do it again? Would he be eligible twice? If he did that work, he should give up his building a home of his own too, but it might be within this time frame. Would he be eligible a second time?
So he's asking if he's eligible, and it sounds like Homeworks might be able to answer whether he can do it once or twice.
So you can have another assessment.
Come on over here.
Yeah. He would be eligible for another assessment when he has a new account set up. You need to have the first two bills in to qualify, but you can have an assessment again in a different property.
Okay. Secondly, for myself, I understand there's a 0% loan available, and you haven't mentioned that at all. Is that from the federal government, from the state? Can you get it locally?
I think that's from Mass Save.
Right.
The 0% loan, do you want to talk?
Yes.
I was going to say,
we have the experts here.
We do.
Program administrators.
And they knew they might be called on.
So there is a 0 APR, 7-year heat loan available to customers, most customers, after they have their home energy assessment. So you want to start with the assessment, and then you qualify for the heat loan, and then you go from there.
All right, I think
that's right. And an MLP.
Okay, do we get everything all set for that one?
Yes.
Yes.
I think, again, there are limitations if you're in a municipal light district.
Correct. Okay.
So, Jonathan, you mentioned the Climate Bank that Governor Healey set up. A two-part question. Have you submitted to get federal funds to come into that Climate Bank? And the second part is, will the potential government shutdown slow that down, or anything else you guys have talked about today?
So the deadline for both the Solar for All and the National Clean Investment Fund is October 12th. So there are teams working very hard. So after October 12th, yes, we will be, we will have issued letters of support to all of the 4 major applicants. Massachusetts is not eligible to be an applicant. If you like, we can talk offline about the pluses and minuses of each of the 4. Will the shutdown affect the entire federal funding landscape? We don't know. We don't know whether, Friday is the last work day. We're supposed to submit things on October 10. Will the website be operational? Will anyone send us a message that the deadline has been extended? Like, if we don't hear on Friday, like, we don't know. So we're just keeping up with the work until we hear otherwise. We don't need anything from them. We just want to demonstrate on October 10th that our application is final, complete. If we need to send it down to the governor's representative in DC and put it under the EPA door, like, we will.
Thank you. All right, over here.
So just a quick follow-up on this gentleman's question up here. It was unclear to me, this
extra fund that the program is in effect, but the money isn't going to be flowing maybe until January. Does that mean that people who are interested in that, being a part of that program, have to wait to take action until next year, or will the monies be available retroactively? That's sort of the follow-up there. Because I wasn't clear where we stood.
Yeah. So none of the monies for those programs have flowed to any of the states. The states need to develop implementation plans. The guidelines to submit those plans, I think, have just been issued, and there is a deadline for when they need to be submitted. They then need to be approved. Then the money will flow. You're asking an interesting question of whether the plans will grant rebates for appliances that were purchased prior to. I don't know the answer to that. I can take that back.
So practically speaking, we should wait until we have an answer if we need the rebate.
I would bet against it being retroactive.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right. The question I actually wanted to ask.
And then check in with your libraries, because they'll probably be on that little digital resources.
Thank you. Many of us here have been working on something that I think would help you, Jonathan, with your concern about where does the extra money come to fund the part that hasn't been funded yet. And I'm curious about your administration's view on the Energy Innovation and Carbon Dividend Act, which is basically carbon pricing with a rebate to the American households. That's where the money comes from, increases the cost of fossil fuels in the market, puts the money back in our pocket, then we can invest it. Yeah. Where do we stand on that?
Yeah. So I'm not familiar with the language of that act. I haven't read that proposal itself. The governor's administration is open to, you know, most all proposals. I will say I was so embarrassed by the warm introduction that I got, but I didn't, so I don't want to more embarrass myself. But when I was younger, the first job I did was administer something called the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative, which is a cap and invest program for the power sector. So in 2008, I did that, and that created a relatively low but steady carbon price. It acts in the background, just the way that there are like bond sales in DC that you don't read about on the front pages. There are carbon auctions every quarter. I think it's $4 billion so far that have gone into all 11 states. And that's now a bedrock of our clean energy economy in Massachusetts. So I know that New York State is thinking hard about expanding that program and using a cap and invest approach to address the transportation sector. Massachusetts was a leader in the prior administration development of TCI, which to be effective had to be a regional program and really stopped being viable when both really, you know, when a number of neighboring states could not get it across the line. So I think we're interested in that market-based approach. We're interested in a number of approaches, but I can't comment specifically on the legislation because I haven't read it.
So I know that Jonathan's doing a ton of things, and there's a lot of good state employees, but Governor Healey does have a proposal similar to what you're talking about. It's called the Clean Heat Standard, and it's being worked through the Mass Department of Environmental Protection, and we're strongly supporting that. We actually filed a bill that would do the same thing. And we'll take it either by legislation or by regulation. And what that would do is it would require suppliers of natural gas, oil, or propane to reduce their emissions year by year by earning clean heat credits. So it's essentially carbon pricing. For those of you who are following that, they would have to earn clean heat credits by giving people incentives to go to electrification for heat pumps, air source, geothermal, or insulation, and so that'll create that sort of shift. Will be year by year decreasing the amount of fossil fuel heat and increasing the amount of clean heat.
Thank you. I need as I said in my classes, a thumbs up or a thumbs down. It is 8 o'clock. That is what we originally planned. I know we got some things that changed. So I need to know, we will give us about another 7 minutes here. Then we will have some time. We need to move out of the auditorium, and we can still do more. So I'd like to take, I know there's at least three people here who have some questions. So give me a thumbs up if you would like to have this continue for about another 7 minutes, or thumbs down if you don't. Okay, I have more thumbs up, so I'm going to take these three questions initially, and then we'll go from there. So you are next, Cher, on this side.
Hi, thank you.
Hold it tight to your mouth.
All right. Thank you. This has been great. I had a question about Massachusetts renters. So I'm currently a renter. I'm very much into the climate and energy space, and I have no choice but to buy a gas-powered vehicle because I have nowhere to charge it. I also have no control over what my heating system is or how efficient my house is besides light bulbs.
Hold your mic up.
Oh, sorry about that. Or besides light bulbs, small efficiency measures. I was wondering if Massachusetts was thinking about doing anything in relation to pushing landlords to do those efficiency measures, even if it doesn't directly affect them if they're not paying for the utilities.
That's a great question. That's a, one of the classic issues in energy efficiency, the tenant owner split incentive, that the owner pays for the upgrade but doesn't benefit from the lower savings because usually the tenant's the one that pays the electric bill. And so how do you manage that? On electric charging, I saw something out of Cambridge that Cambridge authorized under certain conditions, you can run a cord across a sidewalk with one of those like rubber, you know, like when you go, like the, yeah, like more than that, right? But like those rubber cord cover things. So you have one of those and you run it across. If you don't have a little driveway yourself, and you can go across a curb. And so I think you may need a parking permit. You may need like a, you have to pay for a parking permit. People are nodding, so others have heard about this. So that's, I think, really exciting that that is possible. The general approach has been to address landlords in a way that makes it, to incentivize them to do it rather than to require them to do it. Our sense is that one of the other issues that's out there are all of the, that's an obstacle to doing energy efficiency upgrades, is all of the other potential building housing code violations that exist, right? So it's the banister, it's the moldy carpet, it's the leaky roof, and you get someone in there and all of a sudden it's, oh my God. So rather than doing superficial things, it's really how do you get in there and fix it all at once with a deep home retrofit, and how can we design programs with enough flex to be able to address that. The Solar for All does have a 20% set aside for those additional measures, whether it's roof reinforcement, so that is one incentive that we're looking at. I don't know, Larry, is there anything you want to add?
It's a very difficult problem to handle with retrofits. I think one of the things that the state's trying to do is make sure that new buildings are made to be ready for electric vehicles and that they're highly efficient from the start. But it's going to take time to go back to the old buildings.
Just to echo what Larry said, you know, cars, yeah, we need to have more chargers out there. We need the electric car manufacturers have to drive down the price. But like, we're not that worried about that because it's, they turn over every 7 years. Housing, they last 40 to 100 years. And so what we're building, we need to solve the housing affordability crisis.
Yeah.
We need to make it easy for you to buy. But what we build today is gonna be here for 100 years. Right. So we gotta get that right.
All right, thank you. Right over here. And then
hi,
I think
yeah.
There's a second one over here. And I do
I'll only talk for an hour or two, but
No, I think this says concise.
Ah, concise. Okay. There are a lot of issues here just on the federal tax, the federal incentives, right? This is a tiny amount of money. I would just personally recommend that we focus on the tax credits. They are available now. we have to just have to know how we can take advantage of them. And Larry's right that the Rewiring America has done a nice job. One of the things that I'm working on.
And what I need you to get to your question, because I promised them 7 minutes. We have two left and one more question. So
okay.
What's your question?
Okay, the question is, how do we structure the best integration and coordination of the federal, state, and the various pieces of the puzzle together so that it works, and for particular focus on those municipal light plant customers? A few people might here be from Westfield, right?
Yeah.
Yeah,
so,
and that's a municipal light plant. So getting the munis to join up and to get the kind of support for their customers that the Mass Save program is operating.
Who would like to address this? Could
he's
one
with,
of you?
He's with the
John.
Well, that's, that, look, that's, that is the code that we need to crack, right? And we know the problem. The Clean Heat Commission at the end of the last administration included a recommendation for something called a decarbonization clearinghouse. It was originally envisioned as just being information. It'll provide all the, you know, you come to it and it tells you where to go. I think with the new federal monies and the federal monies going into state pots, the idea was, well, couldn't we have this match up with giving loans and giving grants and providing these rebates and really make a one-stop shop? So you can come and say, I want to do this to my home. And you say, well, you qualify for this rebate and this tax credit and this. I know that if my wife and I wanted to do something in our home, like, we got kids, we're too busy to like deal with all the tax credits, right? Like, whether we qualify or not, like, you just, like, it's frightening, the stack of papers. Tax, like, the extension is due October 15th. We're going to be late, right? So you guys are busy too. So I think we need to make it super simple, and that decarbonization clearinghouse is one opportunity. There is a top-notch firm that is helping us to think about how to do that, and that is how we crack the code. That's our best hope so far.
All right, thank you. Now, oh, I do have one more question. Okay, she'll bring it over to you.
That's great. We do this a lot.
This will be our last one.
At Tanglewood.
Yes. Thing on.
Yes.
You guys are fancy.
I'm a homeowner in Belchertown. I've already made a lot of replacements to heating, brand new Pederas, including a thermal hot water heater that's done recycle. We've done the heat pump air, mini split. And now I'm faced with some window problems. But, a lot of these other things I've already bought, and they're relatively new. So for me, it's going to be tough to make some of these other changes. Like, I'd love to go to heat pumps, but I have a brand new Pederas. I'm heating it with oil.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see it happening in 10 years. I'm retired. My wife is still working, but she's going to retire soon. So how would I access any of these funds towards a change, and would it be worth my while?
Mm-hmm.
Either one. You might have stumped him. No.
Well, I'll go back to the fact that by 2030, a million homes in Massachusetts need to get off oil, gas, or propane. You might be not in that first group. You might have, we don't need everybody by 2030. And so I'm just saying the tax credits are there now, and they'll be there through 2032. But let's hope, this can't be the last time that there's federal support or state support for clean energy. So do the best you can. Look for other ways to try to reduce your carbon footprint, but we'll eventually, you don't need to jump at it right now.
All right, I'm gonna stop it here simply because we will be able to still have this conversation, but it needs to be moved out there. So a couple of things before you do that move. First of all, I wanna thank our panelists for taking the time and coming out tonight. I also need to thank my team. And it's not my team, it's our team, but the team, I should say. And that is, please, from another library. We have Cher Collins from the Agawam Library, so we represent our library collaborative.
Love libraries.
Let's hear it for libraries.
Let's hear it for libraries.
And then my our Westfield State University team, we have Professor Karsten Braun here, department, and we have Kali Malika from the Albert and Amelia Interface Center here on campus. And then the last two I want to recognize is from our Voices for Climate, Sue Brown, which I don't know where she's standing. Oh, there she is over here. And I purposely saved this person for last because he did such a tremendous amount of work. And even though he says it's collaborative, John Micklejohn for doing the amount of work that he did. And then the last things I want to say, please make sure you have your digital resources. Please know that the Mass Audubon has two more talks. One, and these are by builders, energy sources, uses, and opportunities, electrifying our buildings, and practical advice. Please make sure you stop by Mass Audubon. Please make sure you get our survey. And thank you, and join us out there. Thank you. Oh, I'm sorry. Look at all these wonderful names I finally got up on the screen. Thank you to all of our partners and our sponsors.
Sure. You said rewiring.